टेल मी अबाउट योर प्लेस।
Now, so far no problem, but it's now raining now, so that signal is coming and going.
Oh, so season dependent. You are also attending our phone.
Yes, sir.
Ramya,
Yes, sir.
Ramya, tell me, how are you?
Yes, sir, I'm fine, sir. How are you, sir?
Good. So you are from Pondicherry, right?
Yes, sir.
So what about Pondicherry network?
Yeah, sir, I didn't feel any problem, sir. It's okay for me.
Okay. Very good. Okay, so I am just picking up some randomly some names. Then I ask, of course, if I ask all the people, then Anand Tiwari, you are very silent for a long time. Anand Tiwari.
Yes, sir.
How are you, Anand?
Yes, I am fine, sir. How are you?
Yeah, good. So, you are from Delhi, right? So, how is network in Delhi? Should be good.
Yes, sir. It's different here. I think here most of the people want to take care, but they have said the call. Okay.
But there is no problem for attending the whole class.
No problem.
Okay, good. Okay, so we will begin today, and if any of you wanted to say something anytime, you are most welcome. But this issues of network, etc., is something which we will not be able to do anything at this moment. The only thing that we can do is, I think Shruti is trying to record these sessions, and if the recording goes well, and if there is a recorded lecture, then you can try to see that later, and if the record is there, I think you can see it maybe more than one time also if required, and then learn this one. But anyway, there is nothing equivalent to a live class. That is, there is a classroom and there is an eye-to-eye contact, and some teaching like that is not possible. I mean, it's not happening. And if you ask me, I am actually terribly bored of teaching online. I am looking forward to some live classes. I don't know when they will happen. It is like you don't see anybody. It's kind of a blind thing, and you have to teach, assuming that everybody is there in front of you. That is very difficult, and I'm finding it quite challenging to teach in a fashion that we do in the classroom. But anyway. It is something we have to do instead of being nothing. So I'm not expecting that, like Debash has said, sometimes it may be completely waste. I also realize that it may be waste after teaching whole of 1 hour, 2 hours. I also don't get any feeling that I have taught. So some percentage of what I am teaching, I expect that some of you will learn, and possibly this semester we have to see what best can be done when we try to meet each other after after the state allows all this. Okay, so let me begin my lecture today. So today I am planning to. So last class, if you remember, we have done formulation of statistical mechanics with classical mechanics as. So today we will try to do review some quantum mechanics and try to understand how this formulation is to be implemented if we have to do with quantum mechanics situation. So quantum effects can actually come at two different stages, in at two different levels as far as this thing is concerned, or a system is concerned. System is made up of microscopic particles. That is what we are trying to say. And if so, we have a macroscopic system. Then this macroscopic system is made up of particles. They are very large in number. Okay. Now you can have two situations. One is that each particle obeys quantum mechanics, but as a collection of particles, okay, as a collection of particles, it is not quantum mechanics is not important. When will this happen? Supposing you have suppose if you have, let's say you have a particular volume. So let's say this is volume V, and each particle, if it is a quantum mechanical particle, so this particle is not a point particle, but this particle probably should be viewed as some kind of a region around it like this. Now this region around the particle is essentially the region around which the wave function of the particle is non-zero. So if you take another particle, then there is some region around that particle. Third particle, there is some region around that particle. So there is some kind of a volume associated with each particle. So I am going to call that volume as Vq. Okay, I will simply call this as quantum volume. Okay, so we will see later that this is defined as H divided by square root of 2 pi m kBT the whole cube. Whatever is there in this, this is called thermal de Broglie wavelength, and quantum volume is associated with this. Okay, so this you can call it as some lambda. Now, what happens is if So let me define this small v as v by capital A. This is a measure of volume available per particle. Volume per particle. Okay. So if we have a situation where this VQ is much smaller, okay, in this particular situation, then this particle and this particle, they will not come close to each other. Okay. Now, when these particles come close to each other, then there is a possibility that the wave function of this particle will overlap with the wave function of this particle. Okay. So, I am trying to describe the quantum effect. Okay, so if VQ is much smaller than this, even though individually the particle is quantum mechanical in nature, but their many particle quantum effects are not important. So each particle obeys laws of quantum mechanics, but as a collection, or as a group, they obey classical statistics. Okay, so this particular situation is applicable in this kind of a condition, then the quantum volume is much less than classical volume or volume per particle, then you have to do quantum mechanics, but you will still be doing classical statistics. But on the other hand, if this V of Q is of the order of V, volume per particle, then wave function overlap takes place.
Yes, can you explain the quantum volume once again? I couldn't get it.
Yeah, so suppose if you have, so let's imagine that you have a particle here. Okay, now in quantum mechanics, a particle is always associated with a wave function, right? I'm just drawing a one-dimensional wave function here, correct? So that means what this wave function is, suppose if this is your psi of x, then modulus psi of x square tells you the probability of finding the wave function at any point x, correct? In fact, this is the probability that particle is in an interval x and c, correct? So the particle could be here, anywhere. Where exactly particle is there, we will not be able to. This is the description in quantum mechanics, right? Now suppose if you consider three dimensions, there is going to be some region around this point, and that is the region that I am talking about. Now this region is measured in terms of a volume, and that volume is given by this. Now, if you look at this expression, this is exactly like your de Broglie relation, except that the momentum is written in terms of thermal energy, kb. Now you can see that you take the same system, but if you go on decreasing the temperature, you can actually increase the volume, quantum volume associated with the particle. That means at lower temperatures, the de Broglie wavelength of the particles becomes higher and higher. So maybe there is a system which is not showing any quantum many body effects at higher temperature, but if you reduce the temperature, then it is possible that the system will go over to classical statistics to quantum statistics. This is what happens in many phenomena, like when there are phase transitions, such as normal metal to superconductor or normal fluid to superfluid. These kind of phase transitions, at high temperatures there are no quantum effects, but at low temperature there are quantum effects, and then the wave function overlap takes place. So that is essentially a quantum volume, and quantum volume is essentially the volume over which the probability of the particle is non-zero. Now you will, if you have not, yeah.
Is that at high temperature the quantum volume is less than the volume per particle?
At high temperature, quantum volume is less. Yes.
Like less than the volume per particle.
Correct. That is why at high temperature, most of the times we will be doing only classical statistical mechanics.
Okay.
Because you can see that volume is inversely proportional to T to the power 3 by 2. Correct. So notice that this VQ is proportional to 1 by T to the power 3 by 2. So if your temperature is very large, then this is going to be very small. Okay. That you have to, of course, compare with this V, because if this V is also very small, when will V be very small? If the number density of the particles are very high, because this V is equal to V by N. Suppose if N is very large, then V becomes very small. Then however high temperature you go, this V2 may be of the order of V. This is what happens in systems like white dwarf stars, neutron stars, in these objects, where the temperature is of the order of 10 power 7 Kelvin, but the density is so high that this VQ is of the order of V, and hence we have to use quantum statistical mechanics. Okay, so when we do quantum statistical mechanics, we will study all these things in detail. But I want you to recognize at this point that when wave functions overlap takes place, the overlap takes place in two different ways. If the particles are, if they are integral, if the spin of the particles is integral spin particles, then there is a symmetric overlap of wave functions. Symmetric overlap of wave functions. Okay, if the spin of the particles, spin can be either integral or half integral, no other fraction is possible. If you have half integral spin, then you have anti-symmetric overlap.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I ask a question in chat box. Can I ask now, sir?
Yeah, I am not. Who is asking?
Gayatri, sir.
Gayatri, when I am doing this. Lecture, I will not be able to read the chat box. So you please ask. That is better.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead, ask.
Can you please explain clearly what is wave function overlapping, sir? I can't get the point.
Okay, sure. So when I say wave function overlap, what do I mean by that? So let's say that let's consider one of the example that you might have done. Let's say hydrogen atom. Okay. Now hydrogen atom has got one electron. Okay, and if I consider this as the nucleus of the hydrogen atom, and I can say that the wave function of the electron in one of the directions, usually it is in all three directions, but let me say that in one of the direction wave function is like this. Now suppose I take another hydrogen atom which is quite far away from this, and then the wave function of this electron is something like this. Okay, now supposing, so this is one hydrogen atom, this is another hydrogen atom. Okay, now suppose if I bring these two hydrogen atoms together, and then let's say that we want to understand how hydrogen molecule forms. Okay, there is a quantum theory of hydrogen molecule. Hydrogen molecule is called Hitler-London theory. I do not know if that was a part of your syllabus in quantum mechanics. Otherwise, what happens when you bring these two close together? That means, let's say this is one hydrogen atom and this is another hydrogen atom. Then the wave functions will overlap. Overlap of the wave function means now you are going to have your wave function something like this. Okay, so when this happens, this is like there is only one wave function for both the electrons, for both the atoms. This is one particular energy state, a one particular wave function. Okay, but there are two electrons, right? There are two electrons, and you can have a wave function which is something like this. Something like this. This is also one wave function. Okay, so this is two types of overlap. This is called symmetric overlap. And this is called anti-symmetric overlap. Okay, so you when you are studying quantum mechanics this semester, that is quantum 2, there is a chapter in quantum 2 called identical particles, where you are going to study how this kind of overlap of wave functions will take place. Essentially, if you consider this as your psi of R1 and this as your psi of R2 wave function, then psi of R1 comma R2. Okay, now suppose if I want to ask what happens if I exchange these particles, that is R2 is taken to R1, R1 is taken to R2. Under symmetric overlap conditions, the sign of the wave function will not change upon exchange, and anti-symmetric overlap conditions, the sign of the wave function will change. Just like you can see that the way I have drawn this wave function, in the anti-symmetric case, if I put R1 to R2, then it will be inverted and I have to multiply with a minus sign to get this one. So this is called wave function overlap, when these particles coming close together such that this quantum volume is of the order of the wave function, of the order of volume per particle, then you will have a wave function overlap taking place. And only when the wave function overlap takes place, then depending on whether the spin is integral or half integral, you will have symmetric overlap or anti-symmetric overlap. And integral spin particles are called bosons. This is the name after Indian physicist S.N. Bose. And these half integral spin particles are called fermions, named after Enrico Fermi, an Italian physicist. And based on the overlap of the wave function, the statistics which obeyed by these particles will be different. So this kind of in quantum statistical mechanics, the statistics are required to study bosons are different from that of the fermions. So we say that this is called Bose-Einstein statistics. Okay, Bose-Einstein statistics. And this is called Fermi-Dirac statistics. Okay, so this is just to, we will do these things in great detail in your chapter 4 of this syllabus. We have quantum statistical mechanics, where we will do both several problems and try to understand how Bose-Einstein statistics and Fermi-Dirac statistics can be applied. So what I am trying to do today is just a formulation.
Sir.
Yeah.
So is this the same as LCO method, the linear combination of atomic orbitals, like the H2 molecule? This theory called linear combination of atomic orbitals.
Yeah. It's also based on, in quantum mechanics, everything is based on linear superposition of orbitals. Okay. So LCO method also is something similar to this.
So you mentioned the London theory of H2 molecule, something London theory of H2.
Yeah.
Is that different from LCO?
This Hitler-London theory, so let me write it down. If you have not studied, you can. It's called Hitler. London. Theory. So this is the first theory of molecules, and LCO method is a generalization of this theory in terms of studying orbitals of bigger molecules.
Okay, sir.
So we will try to look at formulation of quantum statistical mechanics.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, the quantum volume you are talking about, is that volume can be smaller than the actual volume of the particle?
That's not right, because once, quantum volume is of the order of volume per particle, then the wave function overlap takes place, and once the wave function overlap takes place, then there is no identity for these independent particles. All the particles will look like one particular system. Okay, so then the volume per particle itself is a meaningless quantity. It cannot be defined any further, because each particle itself will lose its own identity. So, and hence, whether VQ can be smaller than V is not like in quantum mechanics, you know, there are some unaskable questions. So this is one of the, such a situation does not arise, because each particle loses its identity. It's only a many particle system that you have to consider. Okay, so the formulation of statistical mechanics, quantum statistical mechanics, I will try to do it in two steps. Okay, so in first step, I will try to quickly talk about quantum mechanics. If in case some of you have forgotten, or some of you have not paid attention during your course in last semester. So first, let's understand quantum mechanics quickly, and then go over to quantum statistical mechanics. Now in quantum mechanics, suppose if you have so the state of the state the state of a system is represented by some kind of a ket, okay, and this belongs to some Hilbert space. Okay, this is the state of a system. Now, suppose if you have n number of particles, so n particle system, then the state is still, but in coordinate basis, if you want to represent, then it becomes a wave function of R1, R2, etc., Rn. These are the positions of these n particles, and probably t time. So this is called many wave function. Of course, definitely normalized. Normalization is very important. It is always the normalized states that we consider. So it is a many body wave function. So this is the state. Okay. Now you have.
So what's the difference between Hilbert space and L2 space?
L2 space is Hilbert space, but Hilbert space is general name. Okay. So when you say L2 space, suppose if I write L2 of R, okay, so these are set of functions, okay, set of functions defined from R to R such that integral minus infinity to plus infinity f of x mod square is less than infinity. So dx f of x mod square is less than infinity. So if you have functions of this type, set of all functions which are normalizable, they are called L2 space. Now this is a Hilbert space. Okay. So when you have many quantum mechanics problems where you have one-dimensional problems with the whole real line as the support, then you can choose this space as the state space. But Hilbert space is a general concept. Any linear vector space in which you define an inner product, and there is an additional property called completeness, a complete inner product space is called a Hilbert space.
Okay, so thank you.
Hilbert space, this is very important because this is an infinite dimensional vector space, that is a Hilbert space. Whereas when you talk about finite dimensional vector spaces, there are plenty of Hilbert spaces. But in infinite dimensional vector spaces, Hilbert spaces are very few, and this is one such space. So this is a Hilbert space.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So now this is called a many body wave function, and as you can see that the second point, so let's call this as one bullet. So the second bullet is that the state evolves according to let's confine ourselves to non-relativistic quantum mechanics is equal to the Hamiltonian operating on psi. So this is Schrodinger equation. This is a mini particle Schrodinger equation. That means this Hamiltonian contains kinetic energy of all the particles and potential energy involving all the positions of the particles, etc. Okay. So for example, your H may be written as sum over I is equal to 1 to N E I square by 2M plus there could be some potential which depend upon R1, R2, etc. So this is complicated potential. So we can write down Schrodinger equation, but whether we will be able to solve Schrodinger equation or not depends upon the potential and okay. So in principle, we can say that given psi of R1, R2, Rn, zero, that is the initial state in principle solve the Schrodinger equation, okay, to get psi as a function of R1, comma R2, etc., Rn, any key in the real numbers. So this is the statement of dynamics in quantum mechanics. Okay, so I want you to recall when we did classical statistical classical mechanics, we said given some q bar p bar at time t equal to zero, the initial state, we can in principle solve Hamilton's equations of motion to get q bar at time t and p bar at time t for any t in R. So this statement is exactly same as that statement. So we can get so up to this, except that mathematically the quantities that we have are different. There you have a point in the phase space, here you have a function in the configuration space. Other than that, the objects are different, spaces are different, but I think the idea is same. Now the next issue is that a property of a system is represented by a Hermitian operator. On the Hilbert space H. Okay, so a property is a physical observable. A physical observable is always represented by a Hermitian operator on H. Now you ask a question. Suppose what is that? So this is where I think you have to pay a little attention in quantum mechanics. So if you know the state, basically in this particular case. So let me recall that if you have, you remember your classical formulation. Okay, so in the previous case, so property in classical mechanics is a dynamical function. That is some function of q bar and p bar. Okay, so now if you ask a question, what is, so let's say the state is q bar p bar, and the property is f of q bar p bar in that state. It's a real number, for that state. Okay. And unique real number for that state. And if you measure the property, you will know the value. You will know the value of that real number. Now that real number is the property of the system for that particular state is true, but if you measure, you will know the value. Okay, so this is the situation in classical physics. Now, what happens in quantum physics is somewhat different, and this is what you have to appreciate. So, whereas in quantum physics, let's say we fix the state. We fix the state psi. Let me not write down psi of r1, r2, rn, etc. Please understand that this is a many body state. So you fix the state psi, and then consider a property. Called A, which is a Hermitian operator. Okay, so consider a property A. Now, if you ask the question that what is this property in this state psi? Okay, that is suppose if you ask what is A in I put this question in quotes because this question is, even though we are asking, this question is a little problematic question. Now, if you ask this question, most of the times the answer is, I don't know. I don't know what is A in this. Here we are able to say it is some real number, and if you want to do a measurement, If you do a measurement, you will know that real number. But now what happens in general is if you make a measurement of A, so let's say measure A, on which is in state psi, then what you get is you get some result. Okay, so measure A on the system which is in state psi, you get some result. Okay, you get some value, which is some real number, of course. You get some value because it is a Hermitian operator. Now, suppose if you repeat measurement, same thing. Repeat measurement of A on a system. It's not the same system, but another system, but which is also prepared in state psi. Okay, then in general, the same result. You will get a different result, different value. So the situation is a lot like what we have in classical mechanics. Classical mechanics, you have this real number, and if you do a measurement, you will know that real number, and you do any number of times measurement, same number will come. Whereas in quantum mechanics, you will see that you get different results upon this measurements. So then what is the answer for this question? What is A in psi? So this question, the answer is tossing a coin. You toss once, you get head. You toss second time, you get tail. Like that, you measure A first time, you measure A second time, you get different answers. So what we can see from quantum mechanics is that the result of the measurement is in general dispersed. What do we mean by dispersed? That means it is scattered. The values are not same. If it is one value, then it is no dispersion. But in general, it is dispersed. Okay. But what is A in psi, or what is the result of the measurement? The answer is we don't know. Now we can ask a question. What are possible results? Okay, exact result we do not know, but we can ask this question: what are the possible results? The answer for this is basically eigenvalues of the Hermitian operator A, which are real eigenvalues. So eigenvalues of A. Now you can see that in quantum mechanics there is a very important result or a mathematical structure that every Hermitian operator. Okay, every Hermitian operator Hermitian operators eigenstates form a complete orthonormal orthonormal basis for the Hilbert space H. So because this is something which is in general true for the Hermitian operator acting on the Hilbert space H. Now let us say that this A acting on phi n is equal to a n phi n. Okay, so this is all eigenstates of a n, and a n are the corresponding eigenvalues. Okay, so this forms a complete this set forms a complete orthonormal basis for the Hilbert space. What does that mean? That means this implies my psi can be written, because psi belongs to, remember, psi belongs to Hilbert space, which implies now since this is the basis, I will be able to write this psi as some coefficient Cn into phi. That is, we will be able to expand any vector or any element of the Hilbert space in terms of any basis. So these are coefficients, and so we can get the Cn by projecting this phi n psi along phi n. Okay, this is the coefficient of expansion. Now you can see that you can extend basis of an operator which you are going to measure, okay, or which you are going to study for that matter. Now this structure of quantum mechanics will allow us that if you ask a question in a measurement, in measuring A, you can ask a question: what is the probability to get some A L as result? Then that is given by modulus of CL square, where the CL is the coefficient of phi L in this particular case. Okay, so now you can see that it we have, so as far as result of A is concerned, result of A in the state psi, okay, result of A in the state psi, as far as this is concerned, we have set A n and probability of A n is given by mod C n square, okay, which is essentially the projection of psi on R square. So you can see this is like these are like possible possible results. And these are their respective probabilities. So just like what we said, there are possibilities and probabilities. So here also you have possible results and there are probabilities. Now, if you still want to have one number associated with for a value of A for psi, then you can say that a number associated with A in psi can be defined as, so you are getting different results, but then you take an average of all those results. That means you are going to take sum over n an into probability of that an. This is called mean value or an average value. You know that the probability can be written as sum over n an into modulus cn square. And this is what we define in quantum mechanics as expectation value. Okay, so this is an average value, and this is one value which you can define to what is A in psi, if you ask. But exactly when you do a measurement, you will not get one value, you will get different values, and in general, A is dispersed in psi, and hence you have to deal with this averaging procedure here. So you may see that this is like possibilities and probabilities is like an ensemble, and this is like an ensemble average. But we don't come across this language in quantum mechanics for a different reason, and we will understand what that reason is in a little while from now. Because quantum mechanics, even though probabilities are used and probabilities are result of A in psi has the same structure as we have microstates and probabilities of microstates structure, but there is something which is very different in quantum mechanics compared to classical mechanics. So let's go over to our next case of so this is some, there is a little more to quantum mechanics, but let's not spend more time on quantum mechanics anyway. These are at least essential elements that I want you to understand how quantum mechanics is done.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, go ahead. The possible eigenvalues.
Yeah.
Suppose we have a system of gas. If we try to measure energy of each of the particle in that gas. So when you are trying to measure energy of each one of the particle, then we are getting the eigenvalues.
Yeah.
Suppose we are trying to measure the energy of the whole system. At that time, yeah, we can get this expectation value of A, or the expectation value of the energy.
No. It's not like that. See, when you have a large number of particles, let's say, and you try to measure the energy of the whole system. Now, if the state of the system is such that it is a linear combination of so many energy eigenstates, then every time you do a measurement, one of the energy will appear as the result. But it may so happen that the system is in one of the energy eigenstates itself. In that case, every time you measure, you will get the same value of the result. But when I say every time you measure, you are always measuring on a collection of systems that are identically prepared, and then you are taking one system by one system and then measure it. I am making this emphasis because what happens when you make a measurement, the state of the system will actually irreversibly change, and hence you cannot do another measurement on the same system. So you have to make identically prepared systems in the state psi, and then do measurement on system 1, do measurement on system 2, etc. Then you will see that in general, if the state of the system is not an eigenstate of the operator that you are measuring, then there are going to be dispersed results. Okay. The dispersion value is associated with the dispersion of the results, but it is not associated with the number of particles. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So now, when we come to quantum statistical mechanics, okay. So let us now move to quantum statistical mechanics. When you come to quantum statistical mechanics, we have the same issue that the wave function that we are saying, that is psi of r1 comma r2 etc. rn comma 0. Okay, so this is like a microstate, because you should know the configuration of all the particles. You should know r1, r2, etc., and then you should know this function. Okay, so in quantum mechanics, they use a different name for this. They call this a pure state. So essentially, microstate is same as the pure state. Okay, so we have the same problem that we do not know, or we cannot determine this. That means we are ignorant of this. But instead, what we know is, so let's say that I have a system. So maybe you can say that system may be in some state psi 1. Okay, so let me now use this notation. So it may be in some state psi 1, or it may be in some state psi 2, or it may be in some state psi 3, etc., or it may be in some particular state psi omega, let's say. So there are many, this is one pure state, this is another pure state, this is another pure state. I do not know whether the system is in this state or in this state. So these are essentially possible pure states. And let's also say that I am able to assign certain probabilities for this. Let's say this has a probability p1, this has a probability p2, this has a probability p3, etc. This has a probability p omega, such that sum over I is equal to 1 to omega pi is equal to 1. Okay, so now this is essentially the, so we have an ignorance of the actual pure state itself. Okay, so but we know that the possible pure states are these. This is exactly like what we did in classical statistical mechanics, because we do not know exact q bar and p bar. We said we know only a set of q bar and p bar, and then gave some probabilities for that, right? So this is also something exactly like that. So we do not know what is the exact microstate or a pure state, and we only know a collection of those possible microstates, and then we assign certain respective probabilities for each one of these microstates. Now the question is, what could be the state? So how do I represent this state? That is the question. So how do we represent the state? This is where a very important difference between quantum mechanics and statistical mechanics you will appreciate. Namely, in quantum mechanics, in quantum mechanics, I can write down, just like in the previous case, I can write down this psi as for n, cn by n. Okay. Now, what is the cn? Cn is a complex number in general. Complex number, and mod cn square is the probability of getting an as the result. So if you see, in quantum mechanics, we don't work with probabilities, but we work with square roots of probabilities. And in fact, this is the only theory where we do, where we have to use square roots of probability. And in fact, you call this CN, there is another name, it's called probability amplitude. Just like the relation between intensity and electric field that we have in electrostatics, E is the electric field amplitude and modulus E square is the intensity of the electric field. So in the same way, this is called probability amplitude and mod Cn square is called the probability. Now, if you look at this particular state, I know probabilities. Okay. I know probabilities, but I will not be able to write this. So if you write down something like this, that is P1 times psi 1 plus P2 times psi 2, etc., plus Pn times P omega times psi omega. Suppose if I write like this, okay. This is not a valid quantum state because this does not belong to the Hilbert space. Because these are not amplitudes, these are just probabilities. Now suppose let's say that okay, I will take square root of this one, square root of this one, and square root of this one. Can I use this? This also I cannot use because these are complex numbers, and when I take square root of this, I will have no information about the relative phases between them. Whereas if you have a complex numbers, then the relative phases are important. So if you know probabilities, you will not be able to write a particular state for this in quantum mechanics. So you have to deal with this slightly differently. So what to do is something like this. Since quantum mechanics deals with square root of probabilities as the coefficients, and what we have is probabilities, so how do we combine them? We cannot combine these states at the level of states because we require square roots of probabilities, but what we have is only probabilities. So what we should do is that each of the state, you square the state and then combine the squares of the state. Since you don't have square root of probabilities, now I'm going to square the states. So how do you square a state? So if you have a state psi 1, okay, then you can associate an operator corresponding to this one. That is, you write this psi 1 and psi 1 in this. This is called a projection operator. Projection operator. Okay, so it's like a multiplying state with itself to get an operator. So now this operator is like square of this state. it is in classical mechanics also you might have seen, it's called a dyad. You have a vector, okay, so something like this. You have, let's say, A, B. This is, let's say, 2 by 1 vector, and then you multiply this with A prime, B prime. This is 1 by 2 vector. Then you will get a 2 by 2 matrix. Okay, so this is called a dyad.
Sir, is this the same as outer product?
Yeah, this is same as outer product. Or this is also called outer product of vectors. Okay, so now you try to take this kind of a structure and then define P1 times psi 1 plus P2 times psi 2 etc. You go up to P omega times psi omega. So this is the state which is basically, you define this as probabilistic mixture pure state. Okay, and you call this one as mixed state. Okay, and a mixed state in quantum mechanics is denoted by something called a density operator. This is called a density operator. Now you can see that this mixed state is same as an ensemble. Because in ensemble also we have a probabilistic mixture of microstates. Here also we have probabilistic mixture of pure states. So mixed state is an ensemble. So mathematically, in quantum statistical mechanics, ensemble is represented by the density operator. Okay, so this is something which is like, so if you want to draw a parallel, so it is like the probability distribution function that we have talked about in classical statistical mechanics. So it is like this, and here you have a density operator, and density operator is essentially probabilistic sum of these pure states. So, and once we have this density operator, let me just say that I will not. So, equivalently, if you have I H cross, density operator time is given by the Hamiltonian rho. So this is called Heisenberg's equation of motion, and you get this is like Liouville equation. So this equation will tell you what is the, so given rho at time t, you can solve this equation to find rho at any time later. Now this particular, once you know rho, so given rho, the density matrix at time t, then the property macroscopic property. Let's say you have B and there is an operator corresponding to this B. So you can take trace of B multiplied by rho. So then you, this is exactly like what you do an ensemble average. But I want you to recognize one thing, that when you take this rho has got psi 1, psi 2, psi omega, etc. In each of this psi 1, okay, so the interpretation is something like this. In each of this psi 1, the property B, for example, let's say I call this as B1. So B1 is going to be equal to psi 1 B psi 2. This is the expectation value of operator B in the state psi 1. Similarly, you may have B omega, which is equal to expectation value of B in psi omega. Already this is one level of averaging. Now this is the second level of ensemble averaging. So this B is equal to sum over I is equal to 1 to omega Pi into this Bi. Each one of this is an average or quantum mechanical average. This is the expectation value and this is statistical average. Okay, so there are two levels of averaging that are involved in quantum statistical mechanics, but all of this you can get from this ensemble average. So this is somewhat like our ensemble averaging. So this is like what we wrote in the last class. There is some B of Q bar P bar into rho of Q bar P bar into dq bar dq. So equivalent to this in classical statistical mechanics, you have trace of B rho. This is your ensemble average formulation in classical statistical, quantum statistical mechanics. Okay, so I think Shruti told me that 4:30 should stop. So maybe I will stop here. And if you have some questions, you can ask. Anyway, let me thank you for accepting to come on Sunday. Otherwise, weekly one lecture, we are not making much progress. These are some things which probably if you learn, you will appreciate the subject well. That is why I thought I must share this formulation with you. And once we go specialized to equilibrium statistical mechanics, then we are going to do the business, and that business will be there in all textbooks, so you can also read textbooks and learn.
Sir, B is also trace of B rho. How does that come? Is the definition?
So I haven't shown that, but I will show it maybe later. You can show that. You start from the definitions of averages, then you will be able to show that.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir?
Yeah.
So those probabilities P1, P2 and all those things, are those something which we arbitrarily assume to those different possible?
We have to assign, but not arbitrarily. Because as we discussed last time, that any physical system, your initial probabilities you have to assign. But that you have to assign based on the information that you have about the system. Okay, so they are assigned by you as a scientist, but they are not arbitrary. You cannot assign randomly something. You have to assign based on some certain information that is there with you about the system.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
But let me also tell you that most of the textbooks or most of the courses that you might have seen will not worry about this assignment of probabilities, etc. Because in a typical MSc syllabus, what all you study is only equilibrium statistical mechanics. And in equilibrium statistical mechanics, you don't have to do all this because depending on what ensemble that you are taking, the probability distribution is given to you. So all that you have to do is use the probability distribution to compute ensemble averages. That's all that you have to do. So that is why whatever I am saying is not generally experienced in a general course, but this is a general formulation that even if you go out of equilibrium, you will be able to use this formula.
So does that mean that in general we assign a probabilities, then we compare it with the original system and we iterate it over and over until we get a reasonably good answer, a reasonably good number?
That's right. So finally, you are going to be guided by the experiment. So you do your probability assignment and calculate ensemble averages and compare with the experiments. And if your experiments are quite bit deviating from your answer, then you have to go back and check your assignment.
Sir, I have another doubt. Sir, in classical mechanics, in classical statistical mechanics, a microstate describes the state of a system.
Mm-hmm.
While in quantum statistical mechanics, a mixed state actually gives the description of psi one, right? So that could be the distribution of all the particles in the system. So is it something like mixed state is a macrostate of the microstate? Can we draw a comparison like that? Like if we are considering the particles?
Yeah, so the point is that this confusion, I think, is generally there in many students. So what I'm trying to say is when I say it is a microstate, it is not the state of the microscopic particle of the system. Whether it is a microstate or a macrostate, the state is for the whole macroscopic system. Okay, please first understand this. Microstate is the state of a macroscopic system. Just like I gave this example of your class, and if I take a list of students and write against each name who is sleeping, who is not sleeping, it is not the state of one student, it is the state of the whole class. Okay, but that's a microscale because microstate contains the information about every particle, whereas macrostate does not contain the information about every particle. This is the only difference. But otherwise, both microstate and macrostates, they are the descriptions of the macroscopic system completely.
Okay.
So this is the first point. Same thing is true in quantum mechanics, whether it is a pure state or a mixed state, that is the statement about the whole system. Now, why are we talking about microstate and macrostate? Microstate means that you have complete information about the system and all its constituents. Macrostate means you have no information about the system, no information about the particles of the system, except that how many number of particles are there. On the other hand, ensemble is an intermediate between these two, an interpolation between these two. Ensemble tells you that what are the number of microstates and how are their probabilities are described. That is possible microstates with their probabilities. So a mixed state is an ensemble. A pure state is like a microstate.
Okay.
There is no difference between macrostate in quantum and classical statistical mechanics because that is given by thermodynamics. And thermodynamics is same in both theories.
It just occurred to me right now. Suppose if we are trying to bring the quantum statistical analog to the class analogy, would it work if we are considering the concentration of a sedative gas which was open to the classroom for this quantum statistical mechanics and the crude number of the the students which are sleeping or awake as the classical statistical mechanics example. And considering if there is a sufficient amount of sedative gas within a volume, the student will be already in a sedated condition.
Yeah. So what I'm trying to say is that this analogy of somebody sleeping, somebody being awake, is see, as long as you are able to distinguish two students, okay.
Yeah.
They, you are all still in classical classical statistical mechanics regime only. Okay, so yeah. If you go to quantum statistical mechanics, that means you won't be able to distinguish between the students. Okay, so that yeah. is something difficult to imagine because you have to talk in the language. This analogy, probably we should not stretch it that far. This yeah. analogy, we should use it only to understand what is the difference between microstate and macrostate, and what are possible microstates for a given macrostate?
Yeah. So it is basically like suppose again going back to the same same analogy. Suppose if another person is sleeping instead of this person, the whole wave function changes, right?
So yeah, that the microstate is different. Yes. Yeah. That microstate is different,
and that is a that describes a microstate, or correct. In this case, a mixed state.
Correct. Okay. See, an ensemble is same as mixed state.
Yeah,
it's just a name difference.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
But like you said, here psi one, psi two, psi three are some pure state.
Mm-hmm.
Each one of them belongs to Hilbert space.
Correct.
Then when you are adding them, like a linear combination p1 psi 1 plus p2 psi 2, at the time told that that does not belong to Hilbert space. How?
That does not belong to Hilbert space because when you write a linear combination like that, then only so whenever you write p1 psi 1 plus p2 psi 2 etc. If it belongs to Hilbert space, then definitely mod p1 square plus mod p2 square plus mod p omega square should be 1. Whereas in this case, p1 plus p2 plus p omega is equal to 1. So your Hilbert space structure is such that only mod square of the coefficient is equal to 1. Not so, sum of them is equal to 1.
But then you got root over p1 psi 1 root over p2 psi 2. That belongs to Hilbert.
So that you can say that, but that is a very constricted view in the sense that you are actually, they are not complex numbers, so you don't have relative phases.
Sir, I would like to answer the question. I don't think root over p1, k psi 1, plus root over the k psi 2 belongs to the Hilbert space, because Hilbert space is defined over a rail, over a field. Complex field. P1, P2 are not complex field. They will constitute a complex field.
Correct.
So I think that's the answer.
Yeah. You have to have a complex numbers to have the relative phases to be represented.
So any linear vector space is defined over a field. So here P1, P2 doesn't constitute a field.
Yeah. They are not a field number.
Sir, is there any physical meaning for the outer product you have taken, like the projection operator?
Well, see, when you have a vector, and then when you take an inner product of one vector with the other, you get a scalar, right? You get a complex number. Now, this outer product is you get an operator. Okay, so one is the projection operator has the following. So I didn't mention about that in today's lecture, but then there is something called if you suppose, let's say I have so let's say I have some psi, which is equal to sum over n cn phi n, something like this. I find a particular vector PL, which is equal to, let's say, phi L. Now you ask a question, what happens if I operate with this PL on psi? Okay, so that is equal to sum over n cn and phi L. Okay, so that gives you that sum over n cn phi L into delta Ln, because these are orthonormal, this is delta Ln. That means in this you get only one so you can see that this operator PL projected the general state psi to phi L, and that is why this operator is called the projection operator. Okay, I do not know whether you consider this as a mathematical argument or a physical argument, but whatever it is, this is the meaning of that.
Okay,
so if there are no questions, maybe we can close. So we will meet again on Wednesday. Shruti, are you
yes sir,
are you able to record this session?
Yes sir, recording. Avinash, Shrivati, Sundar, everyone was recording. So right now he is recording.
Okay, because I think last class I did not see. If I don't know if you have sent, I have not seen. But are you sharing this recorded one? So you can share with me also.
Yes, sir. Definitely.
Okay, then we can close. Bye.
Thank you, sir.